Hi, everybody, welcome back to Moscone West. This is theCUBE's continuous coverage of RSAC 2025. My name is Dave Vellante. I'm here with Jacki, McGuire, John Furrier's in the house, John Olczyk, and the entire CUBE team. We're pleased to welcome Deepen Desai. He's the Chief Security Officer. He's got some other parts of his title, EVP. Congratulations, if that's, is that new?
It is new, thank you.
Thank you, thanks for sharing that. That's awesome. EVP of Cyber and AI Initiatives at Zscaler. That's nice, that's a real testament to the fine work that you've done. Multi-time CUBE guest, so thanks so much.
Thank you for inviting me.
Yeah, you bet. I think last time we talked, I believe was one of our super clouds, and we were talking about how security could be the real blocker to that wonderful vision we have of super cloud. And it always comes back to security, doesn't it? Which always comes back to data. But you guys have been doing some good work. I'm looking at this 2025 phishing report. But before we get into that, what's on the mind of chief security officers these days?
AI. How do you protect against AI-driven attacks as well? So, both sides, right? You need to enable your organization with AI adoption securely, but then you also need to be wary of all the risks surrounding that. And you also have the bad guys who are starting to leverage it to the full potential, and that's some of the things that we have highlighted in our recent report as well, how bad guys are starting to leverage it when they're going after your organization.
You know how, this is kind of a weird thing I'm going to say. You know how presidents of countries, they'll do something, if things are not going well and the people aren't happy, they'll do something. I'll give an example that won't offend anybody. So during the Vietnam War, wasn't going well, so Lyndon Johnson flew to Hawaii for a meetup, you know. It didn't work, it didn't distract anybody, but I feel like, okay, AI, it's like this distraction. What about all the other basic blocking and tackling that we have to do? What happened to that? And so, it's a serious question, like, what is the state of that? Is it such that everything has to be rethought because of AI, or is it, you know, AI is sort of a layer on top?
Look, good question, you're right. I mean, the fundamental things still applies, and by fundamental things, I'm talking about the architecture choices that you make. We're a big proponent of zero trust architecture. Mm-hmm. So as long as you're shutting down the vectors, the attack paths that the attackers can take, or even AI-driven attacks can take, right? You're secure. You've simplified your architecture, your network, removed complexity. So those fundamental things still apply. But when you start thinking about AI application, the overall threat model changes slightly because you need to now worry about two things. One is all the data that is going to be leveraged to train those models, whatever application that you're trying to build internally. If you're relying on a SaaS vendor, that's your third-party supply chain risk as well, because we're now starting to see ransomware operators go after those SaaS providers because downstream impact is tremendous. And then the other part you need to worry about is where they're going after your models, the outcomes. So poisoning those applications to result in outcomes that may favor one thing over the other. Mm-hmm. And there are adversarial attacks that are already starting to happen that targets your application from that perspective. It's better called poisoning attacks.
Yeah, poisoning the well. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I actually did a talk at, it may have been RSA last year about it, about common exploits. The other one that's coming up more often now is feature extraction. So that was something that a year ago I mentioned is that we don't really see this in the wild, but basically attackers trying to take your features of your AI and figure out what model you're using. But it started to come up more in the wild recently. Kind of related question, one of the things that I've noticed is that AI is causing security teams to have to be more diplomatic than they've been before. So one of the things that I've heard a lot is, you know, security is always the department of no, right? And they're the department that says no to everything. But I think what security teams are finding is that unless they say, let's help get to yes, the AI projects are just going to happen without them knowing about it. So I think if they want to be aware of what's going on, they're starting to have to be a little bit more, they're having to be diplomats and actually interface with other parts of the organization and make sure they know that security's there to support. I'm wondering if you're seeing the same thing and that security teams are having to be a lot more open to partnership within the organization to maintain some visibility over everything that's happening.
No, good point. Look, in my opinion, right after pandemic, Mr. No security team tags started to fade away because we had to be that business enabler. How do you support that hybrid workforce? Mm-hmm. AI is, I would call it a similar phenomena, mm-hmm. where now you're trying to support business adoption to become more efficient, more prolific. So it's another way where CISOs will have to team up with CIOs and cross-functional leaders in order to make sure that the organization is doing AI adoption in a secure way. There has to be a governance framework, there has to be a security framework that needs to be adhered to when they're investing in AI adoption. Mm-hmm. So, yes, I'm seeing that across the board, yeah. But now it's a second stream. After pandemic, we went through one way where we were already working together.
Yeah.
This is for their
Yeah, the explosion
that.
Of BYOD was insane during the pandemic. Like, just the thought, coming from financial services, you know, I spent a lot of years in financial services where I had a BlackBerry issued by my, just the fact that everybody was now on their own devices, it was terrifying to me.
I was interviewing Lena Smart, who's the CISO over at MongoDB. Mm. I was kind of in a bad mood, and I was griping about security. And I said, what's the answer here? And thanks. And she goes, look, it's easy. Just don't click on links. And I'm like, what do you mean? I'm serious. Don't click on links. Yeah. I'm like, how do I get my job done? She goes, don't click on links, and you'll be good. So it brings me to phishing, right? I mean, that's what she was talking about. I'm like, she goes, okay, if you really, really trust somebody, but otherwise, don't click on links. So. Why the focus on phishing? I think we know the answer to that, but how has it changed? Are attackers getting sort of more precise, more spear phishing, more targeted? What are you guys finding? We can get into some of the findings in your report.
Yeah, actually that was one of the findings in our recent report where the volume of phishing attacks went down, but the quality of these attacks, as you mentioned, spear phishing, more targeted in nature, more context being brought in when they're going after an organization. And it indicates that these guys are leveraging AI to craft those templates, to bring in that current news context as well. There are a couple examples that I'll walk you through as well, but that is making those attacks much more believable and increase the chance of success.
It was interesting, what the top 20 brands most frequently imitated in phishing scams, Microsoft, Google, Netflix, Facebook, DHL, HSBC, WhatsApp, FedEx, I'm Adobe. I'm surprised Apple's not on there.
I just got a smishing text from A-PPLE this morning, and it was the first Apple one I had seen.
Yeah, it's funny, but that's some really interesting data, and yeah, you got some other examples, right?
No, the brands that you see, again, this is all enterprise data, so these are enterprise employees being targeted, but you will see a mix of both enterprise and consumer brands being leveraged as the lures, because there are a lot of the cases where the employee will do certain things on their work laptop, and if they're able to phish and get an identity compromise, they're able to then leverage it to move around, especially if they're reusing certain credentials. Or if they're able to phish and deploy a payload on that work laptop, then again, it provides them the beachhead to discover what else is reachable from that.
Yeah.
You mentioned about a couple examples. I'll give you.
Yeah, tactics are changing.
Tactics
right?
are changing. It's. I completely agree with what Lena mentioned about not clicking links.
Everybody needs a sandbox. Everybody needs a sandbox.
Unfortunately, since last couple years, we've started seeing many of these threat actors pick up the phone and call your privileged users. IT help desk was in the news. I'm sure you guys saw that, where ScatterSpider was calling them. A few months later, there were other gangs that started leveraging the same tactic. They were pretending to be part of a security team. Mm-hmm. They would call IT help desk, hey, we saw an infection on your computer. Can you do A, B, and C just to investigate whether it's a true positive or false positive? It will always turn out to be a false positive, but then at the end of it, they will send them a survey link, which is a link, and if they click it, then that's how they're able to get in.
Then whatever ports they just opened during their testing.
Yes, yeah. And then the most recent one.
That's clever.
Yeah.
Most recent one, this is, again, this has resulted in many successful ransomware attacks over the past 9 to 12 months. They will identify 3 or 4 privileged users in an organization. They will then send spam messages, whether it's SMS, email, large volume of it. And within 5 minutes of that, they will call all those employees at once, and they will say, hey, I'm part of your security team. There was a failure in one of the controls that resulted in spam passing through. let me help you. And then the playbook basically results in them taking over the
It's system. Like getting into the apartment. somebody's going to open it up, right?
Yes. Wow. So they're getting more and more clever in the tactics. And they keep evolving because when the IT help desk phone calls were happening, oh, don't reset MFA, don't reset password unless the manager approves it. Like the playbook on IT helped us evolve. So then they evolved their playbook on how do we get in. So we're going to see more and more of this. Traditional emails will still be there, but these context-driven phishing attacks.
Yeah, and it's happening fast. Yeah. I was actually just talking about that in a previous interview in that when I joined theCUBE, within 24 hours of information about me being put on LinkedIn, I was getting phishing emails from John, from Dave, from
and I
messaged them, and I was like, hey, this is a crazy volume given the fact that I've been here a couple days, but and it's the open source intelligence, it's getting easier to automate the process of collecting it to create those spears.
Yes.
Yeah. So your world, you folks who hang out with the SecOps teams, you must be thinking about, okay, how would I create some kind of phishing scam or
art of war.
So art of war, right. and so, you know, what kind of gamification is going on in the community to anticipate, you know, what's coming? Hard to predict, but any insight you can give us on what threats are coming, you know, in the future?
So we're going to see a combination of things that I just spoke about, but imagine, and this actually happened as well, you're aware of it, where CEO's voice was used. Now, video deepfakes are also a thing. Mm-hmm. But when you combine 2 to 3 of these traditional channels with this new channels, the attack becomes even more believable. Mm-hmm. So we're going to see hybrid attacks where both AI-driven content and the traditional means are combined. An example I can give you, this happened in the last 3 to 4 months. During our appraisal cycle, and this was seen across multiple other technology industry vertical, during our appraisal cycle, there was an email claiming to grant CEO equity that went to a few targeted employees. This was a real attack, and that has happened across the board. Now, fun fact over there, our CEO Jay also received that, which was an OPSEC failure on the AI side. But they're going to bring in this context when they go after organizations, and it won't be just one channel. They will use multiple channels to make it more and more believable.
Well, yeah, because I was just thinking about that, and I'm like, yeah, if you go on Blind, the employee review app, you can probably figure out by people's comments and posts when review cycle is, because people will post that they're unhappy about their reviews.
Yes.
So we mentioned, you kind of referenced Zero Trust earlier. Before we started recording, we were talking about lateral movement and kind of how the nature of compromise has changed, and you mentioned that, you know, everybody should be using a zero trust architecture. I was hoping you could go into that a little bit more. So what we were talking about before we started recording is that we used to have all these services that kind of existed in vacuums, and the cloud kind of tied them all together. And you were saying, yes, that's true, but also that we've moved from you had to be at the office to access it. So can you talk a little bit more about how the nature of the threat has evolved with an ever more connected enterprise, and then how zero trust helps break that interconnected nature if you need it to? It's kind of the firewall. It's the non-firewall firewall, right?
Sure. Yeah. So the way I would explain this, and over the past 5 years, this has become even more obvious. Anything that is exposed to the internet is your attack surface, whether it's VPN, firewall, VDI, whatever it may be. And there are certain things that you need exposed to the internet for business reasons, but you need to protect that. Attackers will target those assets to get inside your environment. This is where VPNs are being targeted over and over again. So when we were discussing, hey, why is Zero Trust now such a big deal? Why is it so important for organizations to adopt that? A lot of these legacy technology, when the attackers are able to successfully exploit a vulnerability, whether it's remote code execution, authentication bypass, and you will see a plethora of them over the past 2 years, they're essentially getting a beachhead into a relatively flat network. They're basically bringing users or the attacker on a network. And then they're able to use automation, post-exploitation tools to move within that environment and get to crown jewel applications, which is where the data is, which is where their target is. Back in the day when everyone was in the office, the thing was, oh, I'll build a castle over here, and you need to be here to access anything within this castle, otherwise you don't have access to it. Mm-hmm. That world is gone, right? The users are anywhere. They could be home, traveling. Your apps have moved to the cloud, so the apps are also no longer in the castle. And then you have data centers, you have emerging technologies like AI, yeah. where you're relying on several SaaS vendors. So you need to have zero trust architecture followed. Mm-hmm. One last thing I'll mention on this front is, to fight AI-driven attacks, you need to leverage AI. Mm-hmm. But AI is not at a stage where it can solve everything from mm-hmm. threat detection, prevention perspective. It can make humans more efficient. Mm-hmm. It can improve the efficacy of the platform. So you should leverage that for becoming more efficient and higher efficacy.
Keyword being leverage.
Exactly.
Not rely.
Not rely on it, exactly. But then you must simplify your network. You must reduce complexity. You yeah. should prioritize zero trust architecture, which will ensure that any path that the attackers, be it AI attacker or a human adversary, any path that they're able to take are closed because you've implemented a true zero trust solution.
At your event last night, there was a tagline, I can't remember, it was zero trust
everywhere.
Everywhere or anywhere, it was everywhere, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I mean that seems to be sort of your war cry, if you will.
Zero trust everywhere with AI enabled platform, yes.
We'll give you the last word. What's happened at the show? What's the conversation like with your CISO peers? And what's the key message you want to leave everybody about?
Lot of agentic AI yeah. discussions as expected. CISOs, like I said, that is top of mind for everyone. How can they enable the business to adopt some of these things more securely? But then there is a lot of fluff as well out there where vendors are claiming to do A, B, and C, but it's not even doing A properly,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
there is a lot of that discussion yeah. between us. CISOs are like, is this really doing what it's claiming to do? There's room for a lot of these technologies to mature. Mm-hmm. And next year is going to be exciting, though. I mean, there is potential, but a lot of these technologies are early in their stage.
Well, thank you for being vigilant and the good work that you do. We appreciate your coming on theCUBE.
Thank you, right. Pleasure.
Okay, for Jacki McGuire, this is Dave Vellante, and you're watching theCUBE's coverage, RSAC 2025. We'll be right back, right after this short break. See you then.